Should we pray? Father in heaven, I thank you that you've impacted my life, that everything I've known, you've given to me, everything I've shared, every place I've gone, everything I have, I owe to you. And I pray today that you'll cover me with the blood of Christ spoken of in the first chapter of the book of Revelation, and that you'll open up to me the true character of Christ, that I might be faithful, yea, even unto death. And Father, I pray that if there are men and women and young people here today who are questioning the existence of God and questioning the impact that he can have upon their life, that you'll speak to them individually. And if there are those that have fallen far from your grace, that your grace is sufficient to bring them home today. And I pray that through your Holy Spirit, that they might say there is a God, but more than that, they might find the power of their God for their own individual life, to lift up their burdens, to take away their problems, and to lead them into the kingdom. So I give you the honor and the praise and the glory today for everything you're going to do for us. Your humble servant. Amen. One of the greatest magicians of all time, Harry Houdini, was a master of illusion and world-renowned for his abilities. He once made a real-life elephant disappear. David Copperfield made the Statue of Liberty vanish. And I recently saw Chris Angel make an entire stage full of audience members disappear into thin air. I don't know how they did it. It was pretty incredible. However, the greatest magician of all time seems to be the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Every year, thousands of teens and young people disappear, and the congregation then ponders how the trick was done. Was it mirrors, sleight of hand? Were they in on it? Using the powerful skills of indifference, gossip, criticism, self-righteousness, guilt, and shame, we've succeeded in performing the world's most impressive magic act. And it's for a church that doesn't believe in a secret rapture. I often wonder what happened to my friends from high school and grade school. It's like they disappeared off the face of the earth all of a sudden. A government-funded study was once done on why prisoners try to escape. In 7 years and hundreds of thousands of dollars later, it turns out they didn't like it there. And the reasons the young people leave the church is because they don't like it here. No one enjoys being in a place where you're ignored, chastised, and looked down upon. And the churches the world throughout have bred this type of hostility. They turn the church into their own personal den of antagonism and oppression and wonder why people are driven away. They look to every probable cause but refuse to look at a mirror. They form Jesus in their image. They decided whom he hates. They know their politics more than they know the true character and love of Jesus Christ. They want the Ten Commandments in buildings, but they forget that God commanded us to write them in our hearts. Even 2,000 years ago, the old people were chasing kids away from Jesus. Get away. You're bothering him. He's got more important things to do. Shoo. But Jesus was their friend, and he said to the older folks, "What could possibly be more important than the young people? Let the little children come unto me, and do not hinder them. For to such belongs the kingdom of heaven." Matthew 19:14. We're slow to kindness and quick to offend. I was at a Walmart once, and I saw a chair I liked, and there was no one there to help me, and it was up on a shelf. So I climbed up on the shelf, about 6 feet high, and sat down, and it was really comfortable. And it felt nice to be up there looking down on everybody. But immediately, this old lady came by and says, "Get down!" I'm like, "Well, can you help me with this? I'm thinking of getting it." "Not my department." And somehow the churches have become like this. We close our eyes to the cries for help and harden our hearts at opportunities to enrich lives. But we will be the first to tell you to be quiet. We're quick to tell you to cut your hair. And we won't waste a second to point out that a skirt needs to be longer. Imagine a hospital that turns away the sick. And we sit around and contemplate the problems and the solutions. Is it that junky music they listen to? Music has been around since the beginning of time. And when I was in high school, the music was 10 times more destructive and satanic than it is now. Lucifer was a master musician. He knows how to speak to the young people. He understands them. And this is the most powerful tool that he uses. When I was in California, there was a man at my church who gave a powerful testimony. When he was a teen, he was into destructive music and had long hair. And he was contemplating leaving the church. And every time his parents dragged him there, someone would go, "You get rid of your music yet? When are you going to cut your hair?" And he made up his mind he was going to leave. Then this new youth pastor came, and every time they met, he never once criticized him. He just introduced him to Jesus. He didn't ask him about his hair. He didn't ask him about his records. He just showed him who Jesus was. And it took almost 2 years, but that man finally understood who Jesus was. He threw his collection away. He trimmed his hair. He didn't cut it all the way. It's still a little long. The greatest challenge facing young people today is not alcohol or drugs. Those things were around since the beginning. Now, you'd be surprised how many older people here were involved. It's not premarital relations or pregnancy. Those things have been around, too. It's not the latest fashion, provocative styles. When I was in London, a friend of mine was wearing a skirt to church, and one of the elders came over and pointed out how inappropriate it was. He says, "Look at my teenage daughter. She's got a long skirt, long blouse, long sleeves. She's in the choir. That's how a young lady should dress." Well, a few months later, my friend couldn't wait to tell me. He says, "Remember that elder who kept going on about how great his daughter was with the long skirts? Turns out, she got knocked up." "Really, who?" "Oh, some old bloke in the choir." The greatest crisis facing our times are not tattoos or piercings. They've been around since ancient days, too. When my grandmother was a teenager, she got pierced. Right here. And something went wrong and she went blind in one eye. And if you are pierced, you know, no problem, because Jesus offers you a new body, a perfect body, unblemished, a perfect form for all eternity if you come unto him. And if you're thinking about it, remember that Jesus was pierced so that you don't have to be. Isaiah 53:5 says, "He was pierced for our transgressions. He was wounded for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes, by the lashes upon his body, we are healed." The devil uses shame to drive a wedge between you and God. But God doesn't want you to feel shame. When Adam and Eve sinned, the first thing they felt was shame, and they hid. God came to them in the garden to cover their shame. You see, that innocent animal that had to die that day, that innocent animal was Jesus. He was the lamb slain at the foundation of the earth. Revelation 13:8. It's his grace that covers our shame. The problem today is not texting, unless you're driving while doing it. But we had, texting when I was in high school. We just did it like this, you know? And you'd be lucky if the teacher caught you. They still catch you today. But the greatest challenge facing kids today, the greatest problem facing teenagers and young adults, is peer pressure. You see, something has to get inside your heads that can empower you to say no to a friend. If you can do that, then nothing else this world has to offer will ever overpower you. Every day in the life of a teenager is a victory. We don't feel the magnitude of the pressure that they feel. We don't realize just how much they struggle to make it through each day. And we often take away from their victories by pointing out setbacks. And the solution to this problem is a friend who cares, a friend who understands, and a friend that'll never put you down. The source of strength to face 2010 is a friend that'll never betray you. It's Jesus Christ, your new best friend forever. But who is Jesus? To young people, Jesus is the last person on earth they want to meet. Many teenagers wonder, how could Christ be my best friend? And because they think that mom and dad, maybe the preacher or the Sabbath school teacher, kept saying, "Don't do this, don't do that, you're bad," maybe they think that's how Jesus talks. You know, he must be my worst possible enemy. I could have such a good time if it wasn't for him. An antichrist says that Jesus came in some different kind of flesh, pale face, hollow-eyed, sunken cheeks, a halo around his head like you see in a medieval painting. He never smiled. He was thin, emaciated, effeminate, and toning in his words like a preacher at a funeral. And unfortunately, this is Christ to many people. He appears as emotional and as loving as a stained glass window on the side of a Gothic cathedral. But young people can't be blamed for thinking this way. Teenagers can't be faulted for feeling like this. It's the Antichrist, Satan, that's going around masquerading as Jesus to mislead you, and he does it through the old people, the church people, us. These grumps are the missionaries of the deceiver. In every congregation, in every church, in every nation, they spread the bad news like wildfire, doing everything they can to push people out. And the devil sends these people out to the churches, to the four corners of the earth, to spread the anti-gospel, that Jesus loves you, unless you wear black. Heaven is for all who choose, unless you have a tattoo. God is angry at you. God hates you. If you talk outside during the sermon, you're bad news. This is what the Apostle John calls the spirit of Antichrist. The deceiver doesn't want teens to know who the real Jesus is. He doesn't want the young people to know that hope awaits them, and and that all you have to do is ask. He's working overtime on you people because he's scared. He knows how much potential you have to change the world, and he's terrified that you're going to tap into it. And it's because of this you don't know who Jesus really is. You don't understand how much he cares about you. Most young people in America believe in God, but they don't think he's relevant to modern times. They doubt that he's loving and caring. They feel he's out of touch with humanity. They feel he only associates with the good people and doesn't want to hang out with us. And the liberal theologian says that if God has no answer for human suffering, if God can't speak louder to the young adult, if God can't understand the life of the American teenager, and if God has no answer for the human dilemma, then God is dead. But I want to tell you today, I want to tell the young people here, I want to tell the teenagers here that God is alive. He still touches us. He still impacts us. He still changes us. And he's still relevant to the human existence. The same Christ that lived 2,000 years ago, the same Christ that roamed the Judean hillsides, is the same Christ that lives today. He's the same Christ that walks the streets. He's the same Christ that roams the halls. He's the same Christ that's waiting for you with arms wide open to take away your pain. But you ask, who is Jesus? Where is he? Why hasn't he revealed himself to me? He's a million miles away, and what could he know about my life? But young people, you must understand that Jesus lived and was tempted in every way the teenagers are today. You can tell him you don't care, but you can't look him in the eyes and say, you don't understand. You don't know what I go through. You don't know what it's like in 2010. You can tell him you don't believe, but you can't say to Jesus, you don't know what it's like to be misunderstood by your parents. You don't know what it's like to be hated by friends. You have no idea what it's like to wish you were never born. He came to this world as a man to understand human suffering, to understand the nature of temptation. He came to this world as a child to know what it's like to grow up in a filthy, wicked world. He grew up in this world as a teenager to understand what it's like to make it through the most difficult and important phase of your life. He was tempted in all ways, just as we are. He came to this world to examine the human dilemma firsthand, to experience agony and hunger and loneliness, to suffer betrayal, and to feel your pain. So that when you come to him in your darkest hour, he'll know what it's like. You see, Jesus was not some guy that lived in a distant, perfect environment, away from all the bad influences. He didn't spend his teenage years wading in the crystal blue seas of Galilee. He didn't spend his childhood frolicking upon the Judean hillsides. He was exposed to the ugly side of life, torment, hatred, the poverty and the sickness. What you see all around you in 2010, he experienced 2,000 years ago. He was fully human, a child, a teenager, and a young adult. He didn't have full knowledge of the cosmos. He didn't have divine powers of deity to help him overcome. He conquered temptation as flesh and blood. You know, there's not a whole lot mentioned about Jesus as a teenager in the Bible. All that is mentioned in his teen years was that he grew up in Nazareth. But that simple phrase speaks volumes. It's often said in the New Testament, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? You see, Nazareth was no picnic. It was no Norman Rockwell painting. Nazareth was Skid Row of its time. Violence, poverty, suicide, empty hookups, bitter weeds that provided an escape for the young people who couldn't handle the burden of life, gall and wormwood. 18 and life, you got it. This is the world he grew up in. 18 and life, you know. The teens had no good time at home. They walked the streets a soldier, and they fought the world alone. There was crime, and there was time, and yet he overcame it. For you. If you think your childhood is rough, the King of all kings came into this world born in a feeding trough for cows. It doesn't get any worse than that. He wasn't born into privilege. You know, they say there's no room at the inn, but if you had money and connections, there's always room. Jesus knows what it's like to be misunderstood and falsely accused by parents. When he was 12 years old and went to the temple in Jerusalem, he stayed back. And his folks had a fit and scolded him. You know, where were you? You had us worried sick. He talked back all right, but he did it respectfully. Did you not know that I must be about my Father's business? He had to sit through a share of boring sermons. Jesus knows all about that. In a time when men preached tradition and works, he couldn't relate, but he had to quietly sit through it. They talked about how great they were and how God loves only them. It contradicted everything he knew about a loving Heavenly Father. His Heavenly Father was portrayed as a tyrant, a dictator, a God who had favorites, not as a God who loves. He understands rejection and humiliation. Your friends call you a loser or try to make you feel like one. Your folks say you need new friends. But Jesus says to all the losers, in my kingdom, you shall be first. And Jesus says, he that findeth his life shall lose it, and he that loseth his life for my name's sake shall find it. Matthew 10:39. He wants you to be beautiful. He wants your skin to be smooth. He wants you to feel your best. He wants you to look your best. And he offers you a lifestyle that'll make you happy. The word of God is not to put restrictions upon you, but is a pathway to freedom. Jesus knows when you're depressed. If anyone tries to put you down or make you feel worthless, remember, when we belittle ourselves, we put God down. Every single one of you has the intrinsic right to feel good about yourself, and no one can take that away from you. If you have frenemies that are always trying to keep you down, you can tell them this. If you knew how precious I am in the sight of the Lord, you would never say those things. You think Jesus is unable to understand what it's like to be betrayed and mocked? No man so undeservingly has been so brutally and unfairly treated before. He was despised, he was chastised, he was misunderstood. He knows the life and struggles of the American teenager. Luke says about Jesus' teen years that he grew and became strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and grace of God was upon him. But he was run out of his own hometown. When he spoke of this wisdom, the crowd got mad and screamed, "Who is this man?" Except the word man here is italicized. A better translation is, "Who is this punk?" You think God doesn't know how forsaken you are? You think he can't understand how in your darkest hour your friends betray you? Jesus was forsaken by mankind. He was forsaken by those he came to save. He was forsaken by his closest friends when he needed them the most. For those 3.5 days, those 3 days and three nights from the Garden of Gethsemane, through all the trials, the lashings, the crucifixion, and the death, it was God forsaken of God, never before in history. Jesus knows what it's like. He understands. He promises you, "Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you." Matthew 5:11-12. You think Jesus doesn't know how many Saturday nights you spent staring in the mirror, wondering what the world would be like if you never existed? You think he doesn't care? You've contemplated non-existence? Would anyone notice that I'm gone? Would anyone care? Would the world be better off if I never saw another sunrise? But I assure you that not only does Jesus know, not only does he care, but I speak of his everlasting promise to you. John 12:25. If you hate your life, there's good news, because Jesus says, he who hates the things of this world, he who hates being compared and judged and put down, he who hates his life in this world, he will keep it for all eternity. Jesus understands your burden is heavy. He understands hopelessness. He understands despair. And that's why he promises you to take your yoke upon his shoulder, if you only reach out and take the smaller weight that he offers. And he begs you, come unto him. Teenagers have the power to change the world. That's why the amount of temptation that you're exposed to is so astronomical. Teenagers are unique. They still have the potential, the innocent faith that Jesus loves. But unlike small children, they have the same physical abilities as adults. They have the same power, the same might and capabilities, only with a clearer mind. Throughout history, from the beginning of time, throughout the pages of the Bible, it was the young people that made the greatest difference. The greatest heroes of the Bible were teenagers. The greatest kings and queens were young people. And the most dramatic examples of the world are spoken of the impact young people have left. David, a young teen, rose up to the challenge of the mighty giant when all the adults didn't have the faith. He had the faith, he had the skills, he had the strength, and he had a sharp wit. Queen Esther, a young girl, stood up to the king of Persia. She had the inner strength and the beauty it took. And it was when Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were young that they stood up to the king of the mighty Assyrian Empire. If you don't believe me about the impact young people have, if you're so used to being told that you're worthless. I used to go to Paris a lot in the early 90s, and it was a place that wasn't fun to visit. There was a lot of hostility towards Americans. There was a lot of antagonism towards the English language and culture. But the young people were the ones who were open enough to accept change. They were the ones who went to McDonald's. They were the ones who spoke English. They were the ones who tried. And 10 years later, the face of Paris was transformed. These same kids, now young adults, they ran the shops and businesses, and they transformed an entire nation of grouches into a peaceful setting. From cover to cover, God praises the youth, and the youth are the ones who change the world. Mary, the mother of Jesus, was a teenager. God called her to raise his own son. She had the faith, she had the wisdom, and she bowed down to the true God. And most scholars think she was closer to 14 than she was 18. It was when Jesus was a teenager when he started to realize the awesome burden, the salvation of mankind, fell upon his shoulders. He saw the priests offer the blood of the sacrificial lamb as an atonement for sins, but no one could explain how the blood of a lamb or an animal could forgive man of sin. It was merely a ritual they were performing for 4,000 years. But Jesus was inquisitive, and on bended knee, he started to realize that he was a fulfillment of the prophecies of Isaiah. "Here I am, O God, to do what you want me to do." Hebrews 10, 5-7. As a teenager, Jesus declared, "I have a body that I can give. I have blood that I can shed. Here I am, Father. Let me be the Lamb of God. I will die for the sins of this world. My blood will be the atonement." He was the epic of all epicness. And when the earth entered into its final stage, there was a young girl named Ellie. God called a young teenage girl and gave her the awesome responsibility of calling his bride out of wilderness. You think Ellen White was some old lady who doesn't have a clue? But she was called upon the Lord, a young, uneducated girl with no status in life. Why did God call her? Was there a shortage of pastors, old men who thought they were prophets? Was there lack of men that looked like Abraham Lincoln or the guy in the box of Quaker Oats? Why did God choose young Ellie Gold? It was her teenage faith, and the gospel broke through like glorious light, and men all over the world started to discover who the real God is. He wasn't distant, he wasn't cold, but he was personal, and he loved you no matter how unworthy you are. James White, 17 years old when God called him. Why did he choose a teenager? It's because the greatest plans of the God above, he rested on the backs of the young people. And in the final days, it'll be the teenagers again. It'll be the young people and young adults that God will call upon once again to lead the revival of the church. But you say religion is for old people. When you have one foot in the grave and the other on a banana peel. But I say to you, now is the time when you have the energy, when you have the ability, when you can cause the most damage in the war against Satan. I spent most of my 20s overseas, and my friends would go, "Europe? Isn't that for old people?" Au contraire, I've had a really good time, some incredible adventures, been to some amazing places, and met a lot of really amazing people. The time to follow God's will is when you're young. But the devil wants you to feel worthless and good for nothing. You hear it every day. But Jesus sees the beauty and greatness you have inside. Jesus knows the power you have to change the world, to change lives and lead others to the kingdom. But self-doubt is the greatest obstacle you can face. You think you're not smart enough? Ellen White had a third grade education when God called her. You think you're out of shape? She was ill constantly and had horrendous health. You think you're not attractive enough? You know, she was scarred, some guy threw a rock at her face. Isaiah describes Jesus as a root out of dry ground, with no form or no beauty that we should desire. You think you're too unfortunate, don't have the means? James White didn't have a cent to his name when God called him to start a newsletter. You know, weren't there successful businessmen at the time who could have had a much larger circulation? He was like the Paul Simon song, "Holes in my confidence, holes in the knees of my jeans, didn't have a penny in my pocket." Paul Simon. Who says I can't relate to the youngsters? Ooh-wee, I was as destitute as a kid could be. Wish I wore a ring so I could hawk it. The greatest part of any magic trick is called a prestige. It's when those vanish suddenly and unexpectedly reappear. Over the years, many parents have cried out and prayed for someone to intercede, someone to step up and lead their children to the kingdom. And the Lord God has heard your cries and offers hope and such a promise. Malachi 4 says, "Behold," verse 5 and 6, "Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children and the heart of the children to the fathers." That's right, God has promised Elijah the prophet will come in spirit and transform the hearts of your children. The promise was already kept once, the last time Jesus came. Matthew 11 says, "Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, there had none risen any greater than John the Baptist. And if ye will receive it," this is Elijah, which was to come. And Ellen White says that there is such a promise made to parents who remain faithful, to parents who pray on behalf of their sons, to parents who plead for their daughters. Before the time of the end, the prayers and tears will come up before God, and they shall be answered, and the hearts of the children will change, and the souls of the sons and daughters will be transformed, and the shadow of Christ will fall upon them, and they shall receive grace and wisdom before it's too late. When God looks upon you, he looks into your heart. He sees your compassion. He sees your good deeds. He sees your awesomeness. He sees the amazing beauty and power you have hidden inside. He sees how the devil suppresses it and makes you feel inadequate or unworthy. And there's nothing more painful to God than to lose a friend like you. Jesus is a friend who doesn't judge, a friend who doesn't put you down, a friend who will never leave your side. Look for the Elijah message coming to a sinful planet near you. This will be one of the awesome signs before the great day of the Lord's return. The Elijah message is a message of hope, a message of inspiration, a message for the young people. And he's calling upon you to be his teen pilgrim versus the world. Thank you, Lord, for the young people. Thank you for all that you have done with them throughout history. And I pray that thou prepare them for the last days. Prepare them for the time of trouble. And prepare them for thy kingdom. Amen.